Morning, church family. Okay, so we are running low on seats. So if you notice there's a seat next to you, if you don't mind kind of squishing in, just so that we can make a little bit more room. And if you want, you could just kind of raise your hand on how many seats you have. We have people out in the foyer. So I just want to make sure that everybody has a seat. Open up your Bibles. We are going through 20 verses today. We're going to be cross-referencing. We are going to be interlocking, interweaving throughout all of the Old Testament and also the New Testament, because today He is risen. He is risen indeed. Today is Resurrection Sunday, and our desire is that we remember beyond just today. So if you want to bow your heads, close your eyes, and pray with me. Glorious Father, thank you so much for sending your Son to die on the cross for each and every one of our sins. And Father, all of us together corporately, we have a lot. And so thank you for the freedom that we get to live through your Son, Jesus. God, I pray that as we dive into your text, that you'll reveal new understanding, that you will unlock keys to your scripture so that your word will begin to breathe like fire within our hearts. God, I pray that today will be the day that we never forget. In your blessed and holy and wonderful name, amen. Amen. Now, turn to Luke chapter 24. I'm going to be reading the first 12 verses. We're going to pause. We're going to discuss it. And then I'm going to read the next 12 verses. We're going to pause and discuss it. Now, there is a lot of scripture that I absolutely love. And this whole chapter of 24 is one that I come back to a lot on a regular basis. And I want you to be able to understand a few of the key things that we might miss when we read it. Because when we read about Christ and his risen life, we tend to gloss over some of the details in the inner working. So I'm going to have you underline and highlight certain phrases. Here we go. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead?" Verse 6, "He is not here, but he has risen." Underline the phrase, "he is risen." Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee. I want you to circle the word remember. That's what we're going to be doing this morning, is we're going to be remembering what Jesus said. That the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified on the third day and rise. Verse 8, and they remembered his words. Circle the word remembered. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. Verse 11, but these words seemed to be on idle tale, and they did not believe them. Verse 12, but Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling in what had happened. Now, number one on your notes, if you're following along, The biggest phrase in this whole text is verse 6. Don't you remember? Do you remember? Don't you remember? Verse 6, it says, he is not here, he is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee. Now, I'm often asked, James, don't you get bored preaching the same thing on Christmas and Easter every year? I mean, it's the same story. Nothing's changed. The answer is no, I don't get bored ever preaching on Christmas and Easter. Because nothing has changed. Jesus was born on Christmas. Jesus died and rose again on Easter. These are important parts of the Christian faith. The reason why I don't view this as boredom is the answer is very simple. It's because how easy it is for us to forget. I mean, look at what the angel said to the women when they discovered that the tomb was empty. Don't you remember what he already told you? This is important for us to understand. Because Jesus' death was the final sacrifice that paid the debt to the sin of all. In fact, turn to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 28. It says, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly awaiting for him. So his death was the ultimate purpose of his ministry. In fact, Jesus predicted his death at least three times in Matthew, Mark, and Luke accounts, not only to the women that came to the empty tomb, but also to his disciples. And also in the book of John offers a few of even more predictions. So why is it so easy for us to forget? This last week we're sitting at a restaurant and my boys were like, "Dad, don't you remember this family that was at our last church?" I'm like, "No, give me more detail." Okay, they dressed this way. There was about three of them. They had two kids and they acted this way. I'm like, "No, I'm still not picturing it." So then my wife jumps into the conversation and goes, "James, you really don't remember?" I'm like, "No, please give me more detail." And so as the more detail came along, I'm like, "Oh, yes, I remember that family." It is easy for us to forget things. And this is why even when 9/11 happened, the phrase was never forget. And how many of us have forgotten about 9/11? We forget about it until 9/11. And then we are constantly reminded and jogged in our memory. Well, why do we forget about Resurrection Sunday? Why do we only focus in on it one day a year? Jesus foretold his death. If you turn to Luke chapter 9, verse 22, this is where we're going to cross-reference and move back and forth throughout Scripture. He said, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chiefs, the priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and then on the third day, raised." Everybody that was there in that moment already heard Jesus foretell his future death and resurrection, and yet they still forgot. Jesus again foretells his death in Matthew chapter 17, 22 to 23. He says, "As they were gathering in Galilee." Now, wait a second. Let's go back to the Luke account here. In verse 6, they remembered how the angel said, "Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee." So now we're in Matthew 17. Guess what? Jesus was gathering in Galilee and said to them, "The Son of Man is about to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and he will be raised on the third day." And they were greatly distressed. So now in Matthew's account in chapter 17, they're starting to get distressed and upset about what Jesus was foretelling about the future. Well, then we go to Mark chapter 8, verse 31 to 38. "And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes to be killed, and after 3 days rise again." Why is this not sinking in to the disciples yet? Verse 32, "And he said this plainly." Have you ever had a discussion with somebody and you've said something plainly? That means write it down. Take mental note. This might come in handy later. He said it plainly. "And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him." So Peter pulled Jesus out from this teaching and said, no, you're not allowed to leave. You can't honestly believe that you're going to die. In verse 33, "But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter." So he brought everyone together, rebuked Peter by saying this, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, I don't know about you, but if somebody said, "Get behind me, Satan," I might take mental note of that moment. I might remember that day. But Peter somehow forgot. So let's continue in verse 33. "For you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Very interesting phrase that Jesus proclaimed to his disciples before he was about to hang on a cross. "For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." So the women at the tomb are experiencing this empty tomb, and these angels are saying, "Don't you remember all of what Jesus said?" Well, here's another one. Mark chapter 10, verse 33 to 34. Jesus said, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes." How many times has he said this? Three. "And he will be condemned to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles. And they will mock him. They will spit on him. They will flog him and they will kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise." Now Jesus is giving them a little bit more detail on what's going to happen to him on Friday. And yet they still didn't remember. But my all-time favorite reminder verse is actually in Luke chapter 9, verse 44, if you want to turn there. Luke chapter 9, verse 44 says, "Let these words sink into your ears." Now, this time he didn't just say it plainly. He's saying, look at what I'm about to say. Allow the words that I'm about to share with you sink deep into your ears. The Son of Man is about to be delivered into the hands of men. Time after time after time, Jesus is foretelling his death. Foretelling his death on a Friday and foretelling his resurrection on a Sunday. And these women at the tomb were fearful and saddened at the fact that Jesus died. The angels appear to them and says, remember what he taught you. Go back to the words he already said. Jesus also had a few more subtle hints in John's accounts. If you want to go to the book of John, the Gospel of John gives a few more predictions of Jesus' death. But it is a little bit more subtle. So it's not, I said it plainly, or let these words sink into your ears. This one, you have to take a little bit more of a heart inventory and mind meld in order to understand it. For instance, when Mary anointed Jesus' feet with oil, the expensive perfume, if you remember that story, Judas comes along and goes, no. Why don't we sell that perfume and give the money to the poor? And then Jesus says to Judas, leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. Little subtle, but hey, you might want to keep that oil for the day that I die, my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me, in John chapter 12, verse 7 and 8. While that particular instance is not explicit prediction like the previous three that I mentioned, this statement of Jesus clearly pointed to his coming death and his burial, and that expensive perfume was used in his burial wrappings. Now again, in John chapter 13, 33, Jesus hinted that his time was short as he told his disciples, where I am going, you cannot come. Now they were probably thinking somewhere in that culture or that region, but Jesus was foretelling his future parting. And then finally, in John chapter 14, verse 25, Jesus talks about giving the Holy Spirit in his absence, which he hinted at his death as well as the future of the church. He's saying, although I am going to be gone, I am going to leave you the Holy Spirit. You would think that every disciple would remember that he was going to rise on the third day. And in Luke chapter 24, verse 8, and I had you circle and underline this phrase, and they remembered his words. Sometimes we need to be shaken a bit to remember a moment. Now, the older you get, the harder our memory is. The good news is we got the Word of God to remind us of all the things that have been said by Jesus and have also been prophesied from the Old Testament. And as Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, Jesus' mother and the other women, went to go tell the disciples, they needed their memories to be jogged a bit. Remember what Jesus said. So they ran back to the other 11 and they're telling them exactly what they saw. The tomb is empty. Angels told us to remember what Jesus said. They ran back and it fell on idle ears. But there's one thing that we have to understand here in this text of Luke chapter 24. Notice verse 12. Who is the only disciple that it kind of rang a bell? Peter. Peter remembered. He's like, this sounds vaguely familiar. He's going, wait a second. I remember. Okay, Jesus did say that he was going to be handed over to the scribes and the Pharisees. That happened. Okay. He also said that he was going to die and be resurrected on the third day. What day is it? Friday, Saturday? It's Sunday. And he booked it back. But what's really unique is he probably remembered his conversation with Jesus in Mark 8. Remember, you know, when somebody tells you, get behind me, Satan, that might shake and rattle a bell. He's going, it's Sunday, third day. He told me to get behind him, Satan. That was painful. It hurt. But now I got to go. And he took off to the tomb and saw what the women said was true. Amazing what happens when we remember the sacrifice. The reason why Easter is not boring is because we get to remember Jesus' death and his resurrection. Now, let's continue reading. Luke chapter 24, verse 13. So, this happened the same day. Okay, same day. Here we go. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. How many of you have ever walked 7 miles? How many of you do it for fun? Okay. They're walking 7 miles. They don't have a car. They don't have, you know, viable transportation. And they're walking, and you could probably bet they're kicking sand, and they're just really down because Jesus is dead. And this is where we pick up. And they were talking with each other about all the things that just had happened. Verse 15, while they were talking to discuss together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. So there was obviously a group of people walking, and these two disciples were talking amongst themselves. Because if there wasn't a group, just to have some random guy appear on your 7 mile journey would be a little weird. So he obviously appeared to them, and they're like, hey, how's it going? While they are talking to each other, they didn't recognize it was Jesus, verse 17. And he said to them, what is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk? And they stood still. So they're walking, they're talking. This individual shows up. What are you talking about? And they stop and they go, are you the only person in all of Jerusalem that did not know that Jesus died? Like, are you living under a rock? Who are you? So they stood still and they looked sad. Verse 18, then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened in these days? Verse 19, and Jesus said to them, what things? Little humor in the midst of the walk, right? What things are you talking about? Unpack this for me. And they said to him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death. Does that not ring a bell yet? Chief priests, rulers condemning him to death. Jesus foretold it 3 times. We just read those scriptures. So these individuals are realizing this and crucified him. Verse 21, but we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. So now they're down and sad. We hoped he was the Messiah. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things had happened. So they're obviously remembering a little bit of what Jesus said because it's the third day and they haven't seen him yet. So verse 22, moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning. And when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen visions of angels who said to them that he was alive. So some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it, just as the women said. But him they did not see. Now, Jesus, we know him to be Jesus, they don't yet, said this. And he said to them in verse 25, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. So what Jesus is saying now is, don't you remember? Don't you remember all the Old Testament prophecies about Jesus coming, dying, and being resurrected on the third day? Verse 26, was this not necessary that Christ should suffer these things and enter into glory? Verse 27, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So as he's walking with these individuals, he's like, do you not remember the stories of the prophets? How about I retell them to you? So he starts sharing the Old Testament prophecies in the scripture. I'll come back to that in a second. Verse 28. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. So this is a long walk, 7 miles together. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, hey, stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far apart. So now they're really enjoying this guy. And they're like, why don't you stay the night, and we can talk about this stuff further. So he went in to stay with them. Verse 30, when he was at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. Now, could you imagine? What a bummer. Like, now you realize it's Jesus, and he's gone. Right? So all you got is the stories of what he was sharing. They felt something in their spirit. They wanted him to stay a bit. He gets up, breaks bread, and blesses it. Then they see him, and he's gone. Now, watch what they say in verse 32. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? We're a Baptist church. We love the Word of God. And the reason why we love the Word of God is because it burns within our hearts. Our hearts burn when we read it. And notice what it says for these two. They said, did we not feel the burning in our heart when he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose in the same hour and returned to Jerusalem. So now they woke up and ran the other way back to Jerusalem to go and tell the 11 and those that were gathered with them, saying, the Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them by the breaking of bread. So number two on your notes, and we'll close up. Verse 27 is a burning within the heart because the Word of God became flesh. Sounds like Jesus was reminding these two men of all the prophecies. He goes all the way back to Moses and all the prophets to interpret to them, to remind them, to jog their memory. Think of these individuals as they were walking along Jesus. They studied with Jesus. They got to talk to Jesus. They learned the prophecies, especially if they were good Jewish men. They would have known all the Old Testament prophecies, all the stories, and yet they were saddened about the events that transpired because Jesus was killed. So now Jesus is alive, and there's something stirring within their spirits. Jesus starts interpreting the following. So imagine this. They're walking down the road, and Jesus goes, oh, foolish ones, don't you remember? How about Isaiah 7:14? Do you not remember that one? Isaiah 7:14, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. He was born. Do you not remember that? He was born. How about Zechariah 9:9? Guys, do you not remember this one? Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout out loud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey. Don't you remember, guys, a week ago? Before Jesus was crucified on Friday, last Sunday, he rode in on a donkey. Whoa! Prophecy coming to true. How about Isaiah 53? If you want to turn there, it's a little longer. Isaiah 53, we'll start in verse 3. He's telling these guys, Isaiah 53, here we go. He was despised and rejected by man, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hid their faces, he was despised. And he was esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs, he has carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. Do you guys remember what happened on Friday? Jesus was pierced for the transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. Jesus' blood on the cross heals the wounds of those that have sinned. Do you guys not remember? All we like sheep have gone astray. We've all turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So Jesus is kind of reminding them about this stuff. What about Deuteronomy 18:15, guys? The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen. Listen to Jesus, the Messiah. Jeremiah 33:14-15. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I'll fulfill the promise that I made to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up from David. You know, Jesus' lineage, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. Imagine being on the road to Emmaus, listening to Jesus reinterpret, reread Old Testament prophecies of his life. And these men were walking with Jesus, and they didn't want him to leave, and yet they didn't know who he was. There's power in the Word of God. They felt something. They went from sadness and sorrow on a 7-mile journey to now feeling happy and excited as their mind remembered what Jesus and the prophecies foretold. And in verse 30 of chapter 24 in Luke, Jesus broke bread with them and blessed it. And in just a few minutes, we're going to be doing that as a church. Why do we do communion? Is to jog our memory of a risen king. And then in verse 32 of chapter 24 in Luke, they said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn with us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" Family, read your Bible. Let the Word of God enlighten you and burn within your heart. Rereading the prophecies of the old and the stories of Jesus are life-giving. So why am I not bored preaching this on Easter? Is because it's life-giving. Why am I not bored preaching about Jesus' birth on Christmas? Is because it's life-giving. His words rejuvenated a sad and a fearful heart. And as John chapter 1, verse 14 says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." Jesus came filled with grace and truth, and he bore our sins on a Friday to cleanse us of our sins on a Sunday. God's words burn like fire. And if you don't have a Bible, please come up afterwards. I want to give you a Bible because I want that same word to burn in your heart as it does in mine. And what these men were experiencing is a great awakening that was revitalizing their spirits because God's word was fanning it into flame as he was sharing it with them. Jeremiah 23, 29. Is it not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rocks into pieces? Now, some of you can remember when the word of God entered your heart. You probably had a brick wall. You've probably spent many years cementing that heart of yours, covering it because it doesn't want to get hurt anymore. The Word of God comes in and breaks it like a hammer. And I remember the day that I realized Jesus was real. It was like this Word came in and smashed my heart like a hammer into 1,000 pieces. And I was like, whoa! Thank you, Lord, for saving me from myself. Is it not the Word of God that rose Jesus from the dead? Is it not the Word of God that conquered death? Is it not the Word of God that rolled the stone away? Is it not the Word of God that made a dead man live? Is it not the Word of God that sets captives like us free? Is it not the Word of God that freed us from our sins, our transgressions, and our iniquities? Is it not the Word of God that we are called to build a house upon? Is it not the Word of God that is supposed to carve through our lives to reflect and bear his image? Is it not his Word that is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path? It's God's Word. The Word lit up these men's faith so much so that they ran back and found the 11 and gathered them together. And in verse 34, they said, "The Lord has risen indeed." Guys, you don't understand. We just walked with him for 7 miles. He's alive. We saw him. Why do we celebrate Easter? Because Jesus paid a huge price for his church. Why do we gather? Why do we gather as a church? Because Jesus paid a huge price to gather. Why do we preach the gospel and the forgiveness of sins? Because Jesus paid a huge price for us. May today be the day that your heart burns. Something stirring around inside you. And you're like, I'm feeling something. I'm not quite sure what it is. May today be the day that your heart and your mind is jogged to the reminder of the memory of his promises all throughout Scripture. that Jesus would die on a Friday and be risen on a Sunday. May today be the day that your heart is sparked with a new understanding of Easter. Easter is more than eggs. It's far more than a bunny with buck teeth. It is far more than the ham that's cooking in the oven or the turkey that you're about to eat as a family. May today be the day that you are no longer bored celebrating a risen king. I remember growing up in the church as a kid, I'm like, oh, Easter again. I got to wear a suit and a tie, take photos, hear the same Jesus story. May it unlock a newness, an experience. May his spirit fall upon your soul and rejuvenate you. Apply the gospel to your everyday life and the rhythms of your life. Live as though Christ is alive. Living as though Christ died for our sins is not enough. We must live that he is risen. Thank you, God, for Friday, but thank you, Lord, that you're alive. Jesus was not a martyr that was just defeated for our transgressions, but a reigning king, resurrected and victorious over the sting of death and sin. This causes us to walk in victory, not defeat. I'll tell you right now, the church became and was birthed because he was alive. The church now scattered because he was alive. The church now multiplied because he was alive. Everything that they were taught by Christ now came to the forefront of their mind, and they couldn't wait to go spread and share the gospel. Family, we are a church that I hope we can't wait to go and spread this good news. This is more than just a happy little day that church people celebrate. This is our life. And now we get to celebrate this in communion. Now, we celebrate communion on the first Sunday of every month. And the reason why is to jog our memory, once again, of Jesus' death and his sacrifice. Now, what you will notice is there's two tables. And we have the COVID communion and the non-COVID communion. Okay? We want to be sensitive. The COVID communion is an individual cup that has a wafer inside the first layer, and then the second is the juice. No one's touched it but you. And then we have the non-COVID communion, that is the tray that has crackers in it, and then the trays that have juice. And after we partake in communion, we get to hear testimonies of people that are ready to proclaim that Jesus is alive and risen through the act of baptism. So I hope you could stay and watch and celebrate Jesus living in the lives of young people and older people. Amen? Now, here's my only warning. Please don't take communion if there's an unresolved issue, sin in your life. Take this moment to repent for that. If there's an issue between you and a brother and a sister, repent from that too before you take it. Because Jesus gives a very fair warning to the disciples when he broke bread with them and offered this to them. He said, don't do it because you don't want a whole lot of judgment on you unless you're freed from all this junk that's inside. So let's pray. Glorious Father, thank you for your reminder. God, I pray that your reminder goes way beyond today. I pray that your reminder goes right down to the very core of our souls. God, I pray that we will begin to pick up our Bibles and read it, reread it. Reread the stories that you told your disciples. Reread the prophecies of the Old Testament declaring that you are going to die and be alive. God, thank you for your risen King. Thank you for the blood that he shed on a Friday to wash over our sins today. Lord, help us to remember this as we take communion. In Jesus' name, amen.